So for Buddhist Action Month, I've been asked to speak about what the Bodhisattva ideal means to me. And it's something I'm really happy to talk about because it sits at the heart of the Eco-Dharma Centre where I work and in the community that I live in here in Catalonia. In the early 2000s, the dominance of neoliberal economics and politics left very little scope for alternatives. And combined with a deep intransigence regarding climate change, there was a real resonance to Frederick Jameson's claim that it was easier to imagine the end of the world than it was to imagine the end of capitalism. So today that's changed. The failure of economic growth, a sense of distributive injustice, bankrupted leadership, and the fierce urgency of the ecological now are the cracks out of which a renewed radical imagination is pushing up in Europe. The emergence of this renewed sense of social possibilities can be seen in many developments across the continent. Just this week, I got back from a gathering of NEON, the New Economy Organisers Network, on the theme of active democracy. Around 30 of us spent a few days in Barcelona, sharing skills and experience of working towards systemic change for social justice and ecological integrity. And it's really inspiring, it's really heartening to see so many talented people bringing about new and creative approaches to political organising and community building. There's something really fresh happening. There's a whole wave of inspired participatory politics unfolding in Spain, in France, in the Balkans and in other countries. And in many places the ground is moving in ways that the old political order just can't read anymore. And yet, if these progressive social movements are going to transition into life-affirming economies and ways of living, they need nurturing, they need strengthening, they need skilled collaborative efforts, talented and astute leadership, and responsive strategies and tactics. To be successful, as well as the social and political dimensions, we also need to attend to the flourishing of the individuals who make up these movements. Mobilising to address the enormous ecological, economic and political challenges that these movements have in their sights involves integration of social transformation with personal transformation. It's vital that we recognise that inner and outer transformation are intimately bound together. To empower outer social engagement, we need inner resources. We need to develop emotional resilience to sustain our long-term action. We need to cultivate bright and responsive awareness so we really learn from our efforts and to avoid narrow-mindedness or ideological dead ends. We need to deepen compassion to meet the immensity of the pain and the challenges we face. And we need to unlock wisdom so that we don't just reproduce the problems that we're trying to solve. We need to nurture patience to turn the difficulties of working with others into creative collaborations. And we need to find deep wellsprings of energy and courage. The development of these qualities is at the very heart of the Bodhisattva ideal. Its power lies in its capacity to unite the inner and the outer. Its vitality comes from the demand that we live our lives in the midst of the simultaneous transformation of ourselves and the world. It's about a radical commitment to self-transformation for the good of the whole, the personal, the social, the ecological. So the Bodhisattva ideal emphasises that empowering effective social engagement requires inner personal growth. At the same time, it also insists that authentic inner growth requires outer engagement. Spiritual practice can become a trap. By offering some kind of personal salvation or a place of individual peace, it can encourage indifference towards the social and ecological systems that we depend on. It can amplify the individualism so common in our times and compound self-centered escapism. This danger has been true of many religions, to the extent that they've emphasised cosmological dualism and individual salvation. Living in a time where socio-economic forces have eroded communities, led to social atomisation, to widespread withdrawal into individualism, we need to be especially careful about this. Under these circumstances, many of us were really unsurprised to hear the philosopher Slavoj Žižek claim in recent years that Western Buddhism, as he says, presents itself as the remedy against the stress of capitalism's dynamics. He goes on, by allowing us to uncouple and retain some inner peace, it actually functions as the perfect ideological supplement to capitalism. So I'm not suggesting we accept his critique at face value, but I do think it's something we need to guard against. The pitfall of deteriorating into a religion of withdrawal has challenged Buddhism historically. We see the danger in the early Buddhist depiction of the goal of the spiritual life as release into a somewhere else nirvana and the arahant ideal. And historically, the bodhisattva ideal of the Mahayana offered itself as an antidote. The Mahayana philosophized the non-duality of nirvana and samsara, antidoting a cosmological dualism, and it emphasized the centrality of compassionate and altruistic motivation for Dharma practice, antidoting individualistic preoccupation. This Mahayana bodhisattva spirit is brilliantly articulated today through what we can call engaged Buddhism. That is Dharma practice that's committed to social and ecological engagement. As engaged Buddhists, we use the creative tension between the transformation of ourselves and the transformation of the world as a catalyst for liberation. We recognize that our liberation and the liberation of others are inseparable. We know that it's through our efforts to liberate ourselves and others together that we truly come alive. Engaged Buddhism and Eco-Dharma, like the Bodhisattva ideal, reframes the goal of Dharma practice. Spiritual practice is not about personal release or individual salvation, but about liberating our capacity to remain amidst the struggles of this world for the benefit of all beings. Traditionally, this is summed up in the Sanskrit phrase apratishita nirvana, the liberation that is not dwelling in nirvana. It's also referred to as the nirvana in which the bodhisattva does not turn back from either nirvana or samsara. The Japanese Buddhist scholar Gajin Nagao likes to point out that the Dharma includes two directionalities, ascent and descent. It includes both the ascending deconstructive movement of wisdom and the descending creative movement of compassion, the interplay of emptiness and dependent arising. And it's not that we first ascend to wisdom and then descend with compassion back into the world. Rather, these two movements unfold simultaneously. So this simultaneity of wisdom and compassion is beautifully revealed in the story of Asanga and his vision of Maitreya Buddha. So Asanga was the founder of the Yogacara school, the brother of Vasubandhu. And he spent many months in a cave, in seclusion, meditating, seeking a vision of Maitreya, the next Buddha. But after many months, he eventually gives up and he walks down the path back towards the village or the monastery down below that he'd come up from. But on the path, he finds he sees an injured dog with a festering wound. And he feels compassion for the dog and he goes to help the dog. And then he sees in the wound of the dog, it's full of maggots, it's infested with maggots. And he feels compassion for the maggots. And to help the dog and the maggots, he begins to use his tongue to very carefully remove the maggots from the wound of the dog. And as he kneels down to do that, the dog suddenly turns into Maitreya Buddha. So here in this story, it's like wisdom, true wisdom and realization arise as we give up trying to escape to some higher plane, to some as somewhere else nirvana. The meeting of Buddha nature happens when we engage in this world wholeheartedly with an unsqueamish commitment. The Bodhisattva ideal asks us to frame our liberation amidst the ongoing struggle for the benefit of all beings. Liberation is not about leaving behind the struggles of this world, but discovering how we can free up enormous creative potential amidst those struggles. When we reject the false dualism of a somewhere else individual salvation, we truly flourish. As Dilgo Khyentse puts it, when we recognise the empty nature, the energy to benefit others dawns, effortless and uncontrived. The Bodhisattva is not just an ideal, just something to aspire towards. It's a path of training. The Bodhisattva represents specific and practical methods to transform ourselves for the benefit of the world. So this is the kind of training that we've been developing at the Eco-Dharma Centre, and it's perhaps best represented in our Engaged Buddhist Training Programme. Engaged Buddhist Training offers tools for radical personal empowerment. It's about resourcing action for social justice and ecological intelligence. Our Engaged Buddhist Training supports us to empower each other, strengthening our capacity for collective agency. So what excites me most about the Bodhisattva ideal is working to make it tangible, working with others to make it specific and applicable to the needs of our times, and through that, supporting us all to flourish spiritually, socially, and ecologically. Thanks. Thank you.